Favor Church. Welcome to our English service. Let's praise the Lord. Let's open our hearts and let Him know that we are available.
You call, I am.
We are available, Lord. We are available to you, Lord. Send us, Lord. Send us. Let's pray for all of those needs and prayer requests received by Favor Church. Let's elevate those to the Lord, because we believe and we know that our God is almighty and he will act upon every single need out there. In the name of Jesus Christ, we believe so. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, because we know that you are putting your powerful hands over all of those needs. And we just want to say thank you. Thank you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray and we say amen. Amen. Let's continue worshiping our Lord. And let's sing about how great his love is. So great that we cannot even begin to describe it.
Shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up. What the word reckless means, it's somehow like messy, somehow like you cannot put it in four walls, but that's the love of our God, right? He just gives love and he loves us without measure, without any standards. He's just our God and it's always loving us. And as we talk about this, to begin with, I want to give some announcements for today. Today is a very special day. Today is August 23rd. And today we are turning 6 months as a church. Woo! We are so excited. We launched Favor Church on February 23rd. And today, exactly today, it's 6 months since we launched church. And it's been a crazy ride, right? We started at the school and then we had to close down and we started doing church virtual. And this whole thing that happened this past few months. But here we are following what God called us to do, and the amazing team behind everything we do. That's, for me, one of the greatest things. It's the fact that we get to serve God, and we get to do it together as a family. And that is amazing. So that's our first announcement. So excited about that. And something else that we want to share with you is that next Sunday, we're going to have two guest speakers at our services, our Spanish and English service. We're going to have Pastor Alex Agat and Richard McCarty from Calvary, Miami, a church down in Miami. There are our overseers as a church as well. We had Pastor Robert a few weeks ago, and now we're having them. There are the other two overseers for us as a church, and we're so excited to have them. They're like family to us. We love them, and you cannot miss it. You cannot miss it. So just make sure you tune on Sunday, next Sunday, and for you not to miss everything that's happening, please just make sure you follow us on social media through Instagram, through Facebook. You can follow our YouTube channel as well. That way you can find out everything that is coming on, in the next few weeks. So just make sure to follow us through that. And right now, if you're seeing us through Facebook right now, you can hit the little button that says share so somebody else can hear the message that God has for us this afternoon. Amen. So the next part of our service, and as we continue worshiping God, is our offerings, our time of giving our offerings and tithes. And for this moment, I love what I was talking about, what these songs are all about. And it was about God just giving and that reckless love that he has for us, because that is our God. Our God is our God that gives. And there's a verse in Philippians 2, verse 5, that says, "The attitude you should have is the one that Christ Jesus had." And the attitude that Jesus had was a servant. He came here to serve and not to be served. And that is what we're doing as a church, thanks to you, thanks to your help, thanks to your generosity. One of the things that is happening right now as we are here in the service, some of the girls in our team, they're over there, they're in a place right now where they're cutting the hair of the kids from the foster homes that we help out, that we are blessing, thanks to your generosity. So they're getting brand new haircuts for the start of school that is tomorrow. So that, the fact that we get to do that, it's thanks to you and thanks to your generosity. So thank you for that, because that's how we're blessing our city and we're showing the love of God through these actions. Amen. So let's pray for this time of giving. God, Jesus, I want to thank you, God. Thank you for the opportunity once again. Not because we have to, but because we have the opportunity to do this, God. To be part of what you are doing, God. Thank you because we get to give for your work, for the work that you are doing here, God, through your church, Jesus. Thank you for letting us be part of this. I ask you to bless every person that give, every person that is watching right now, God. Bless them, bless their homes, bless their jobs. And I ask for a special protection over their kids as they start school tomorrow, God. I ask you to protect the whole family, God. Thank you. Thank you because you're a God that gives. Before we even get to give, you always give first, Jesus. And thank you for that. In the name of Jesus, amen. Family, there are different ways that you can give. You can see them right there in the screens. You can do it through text message. You can do it through the webpage. Or you can text the word give to the number 813-696-6161. You can see it right there as well. All right, church. And now we want to show you a video. We have a conference happening next week. It's going to be in Spanish, the conference, but it's a marriage conference. And maybe you are bilingual, or maybe you know a couple that they speak Spanish, and maybe you can share this with them. So I want to show you the next video about the conference.
Hola amigos, estamos súper emocionados de invitar a todas las parejas a ser parte
de una conferencia. Esta conferencia se llama Amor del Bueno.
Que más que una conferencia, es realmente una experiencia.
Va a ser un evento para todas las parejas.
El 27 y 28 de agosto tendremos dos noches
donde vamos a estar compartiendo a través de Zoom.
Van a ser dos noches súper especiales para invertir en nuestra relación. Así que te esperamos por allí.
Además va a ser gratuito y estaremos conectados con parejas de otras iglesias en toda Latinoamérica.
La idea es esta, que separes la fecha en tu calendario, que te registres para que tengas tu acceso asegurado.
Y por correo te va a estar llegando toda la información para esta conferencia.
Así que separa la fecha, mantente expectante porque va a ser buenísima la experiencia.
Así que ahí te esperamos en
Amor del Bueno.
Good morning, Favor Church. Good afternoon. Welcome our English service today, and hoy día es un día muy especial.
And today it's a very special day.
Tengo a mi lado la mejor compañía, lo mejor de mis días.
I have next to me my best company, the best thing in my days.
Y hoy día, familia, vamos a seguir hablando un poco del matrimonio.
And today we're going to continue talking about marriage.
Pero antes no puedo dejar de pasar y decir feliz primero seis meses, Favor Church.
But first of all, I don't wanna let this opportunity go for me to say happy first 6 months, Favor Church.
Qué increíble seis meses, familia, que hemos vivido.
It has been an amazing 6 months what we've been through.
Y puedo decir y podemos decir gracias Dios por tu fidelidad.
And we can say thank you God for your faithfulness.
Así es. Y como dijo mi esposa al comienzo, en estos seis meses, lo mejor de todo es la familia que hemos creado aquí en Favor Church.
And like my wife said at the beginning, the best thing about these 6 months is the family we've created here in Favor Church.
Así que nuevamente, feliz seis meses, Favor Church. Lo mejor está aún por delante en el camino.
So happy anniversary, happy 6 months, Favor Church. The best is still ahead.
Así es. Familia, también quiero rápidamente mencionarlo nuevamente, si recién te estás conectando, próximo domingo no te pierdas Favor Church, 10:30 y 12:30 de la tarde.
Family, I also want to repeat this and remind you this, if you're getting connected right now and you haven't heard it before, we have our guest speakers next weekend, next Sunday, 10:30 in Spanish and 12:30 in English.
Invitados especiales para nosotros. Es un honor contar con Pastor Alex Zagot y Pastor Richard McCartney.
It is very special for us. They're special guests for us. And it's Pastor Alex Zagot and Richard McCartney. They're going to be our special guests next week.
Así es. Ellos son de Calvary, Miami, ahí en Kendall, en Miami.
They are the lead pastor and a pastor of Calvary, Miami. They're in Kendall, Miami.
Pero no solo eso, sino son nuestros pastores supervisores aquí en Favor Church. Así que no te lo puedes perder. Va a ser un privilegio tenerlos con nosotros.
But not only that, but they're also our overseers here at Favor Church. So you cannot miss it. It's going to be a great privilege to have them with us.
Así es. Familia, la semana pasada comenzamos con una serie de enseñanzas acerca del matrimonio, acerca del amor, y titulamos Persigue el Amor.
Family, last week we started with this small teaching series about love, calling Chasing Love.
Y hablamos acerca de un principio la semana pasada que quedó grabado en mi corazón. El amor no es un sentimiento, el amor no se trata de sentimientos, el amor es una decisión.
And we spoke last week, we gave this one principle that is the one thing I really want you to remember, and that is that love is not a feeling, love is a decision.
Y hoy día, familia, vamos a seguir hablando del matrimonio, del amor, pero específicamente vamos a tocar el matrimonio, el matrimonio.
And today we're going to keep on talking about love, but today specifically we want to talk about marriage.
Y vamos a compartir tres principios rápidamente en una conversación con mi esposa.
And we're going to have this conversation with three principles that we want to share with you.
Los voy a mencionar ahora y seguro van a salir en las pantallas. Tres principios sobre el matrimonio basados en la palabra de Dios.
And I'm going to mention them right now, and I'm sure you're going to see them there on the screens. There are three principles based on the Word of God.
El primer principio es el matrimonio es un diseño de Dios.
The first principle is that marriage is God's design.
El segundo principio, el matrimonio es entre un hombre y una mujer.
The second principle is that marriage is between a man and a woman.
Y el tercer principio, el matrimonio es un pacto.
And the third one is that marriage is a covenant.
Y de estos tres principios quiero sacar una frase que te animo a que la apuntes en tu celular, en un cuaderno.
And from these three principles, I want to give you one phrase that I encourage you to write it down somewhere.
Dios diseñó el matrimonio como un pacto entre un hombre y una mujer.
Marriage is a covenant that God designed between a man and a woman.
En esta frase están los tres principios. Resumidos en una sola frase.
In this phrase, we see the three principles all together in one phrase.
Dios diseñó el matrimonio como un pacto entre un hombre y una mujer.
Marriage is a covenant that God designed between a man and a woman.
Familia, ¿cuánto sabemos que los planes de Dios son perfectos?
Family, how many of us know that God's plans are perfect?
El matrimonio fue un plan de Dios. Dios diseñó el matrimonio.
Marriage was a plan that God designed, and He designed marriage.
Y muchas veces nosotros tenemos planes. Muchas veces tenemos planes, pero siempre los planes de Dios van a ser mejores.
And a lot of times we ourselves have plans, but always the God's plans are always going to be better than ours.
Y lo primero que te quiero decir en esta mañana, familia, que el matrimonio no fue una idea de un hombre. Fue una idea, fue el plan de Dios.
And the first thing I want to tell you this morning is that marriage was not an idea that came from men. It's an idea that came from God.
Es el plan de Dios. Y para eso, familia, hoy día quiero ir a la palabra de Dios, pero no solo a la palabra de Dios, sino al libro de Génesis.
And for that, family, today I want to go to the Word of God, but not only the Word of God, but actually to the first book, the book of Genesis.
Porque si vamos a hablar del matrimonio, quiero ir a la raíz, al origen de todo.
Because if we're going to talk about marriage, I want to go right to the root of it. I want to go to the origin.
Y justamente la palabra Génesis significa el origen de todo.
And actually the word Genesis means the origin of everything.
Y quiero ir al capítulo 2 del libro de Génesis, al verso 21.
And I want to read first Genesis chapter 2, verse 21. It says, "So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep, and while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's rib and then closed up the place with flesh."
Una costilla. La palabra de Dios dice que nuestro Dios utilizó una costilla de Adán para crear a Eva.
A rib. The word of God says that God used a rib from Adam to create Eve.
¿Y alguna vez, familia, te has puesto a preguntar por qué Dios utilizó una costilla? ¿Por qué de la costilla de Adán?
And have you ever asked yourself, why is it that God used a rib from Adam?
Y es interesante, familia, porque la palabra de Dios siempre nos da principios en cada detalle.
And it's very interesting because the Word of God always gives us details, very principles in every detail.
Y acá hay tres principios en este pequeño detalle acerca del por qué Dios usó la costilla de Adán.
And over here in this part of the word, we can see three principles of why is it that God used the rib of Adam.
El primer principio por qué Dios usó la costilla de Adán es por un principio de igualdad. Déjame explicarlo.
The first principle of why God used a rib from Adam was because of a principle of equality.
Dios escogió crear a Eva del costado de Adán. Del costado de Adán, no de arriba, no de abajo, sino del costado de Adán.
God decided to create Eve from the side of Adam, not from his feet or from his head, not above or below, but from right his side.
Del costado de Adán para estar al lado, de lado a lado. El hombre no es más que la mujer no es más que el hombre, somos iguales.
So he created Eve from Adam's side, right next to him, because men are not more than women, or women are not more than men. We are equal.
Tenemos el mismo valor. En otras palabras, tenemos el mismo valor ante Dios. Por eso, Dios utilizó la costilla del costado de Adán para estar siempre de lado a lado.
In other words, we have the same value to God's eyes. That is why God used Adam's rib, so that we can be side by side.
No usó los pies, no usó la cabeza, no usó la espalda, usó el costado.
God didn't use the feet or the head, or he didn't use the back of it, he used the side.
Tenemos el mismo valor ante Dios. Hombre y mujer, marido y mujer, tenemos el mismo valor, pero somos diferentes.
We have the same value, wife, husband and wife. We have the same value in God's eyes, but we are different.
Tenemos diferencias que saltan a la vista.
We have differences that are obvious.
Y yo quiero dejar claro esto, familia. Nosotros somos diferentes, pero esas diferencias no hacen que tú seas más o menos que tu esposa.
And I want to make this very clear. We are different, but these differences don't make us be better or worse than your wife or your husband.
Estas diferencias nos hacen un complemento perfecto ante los ojos de Dios.
These differences make us a perfect complement before God's eyes.
El primer principio por qué Dios utilizó una costilla es el principio de igualdad, para estar de lado al lado, hombro con hombro.
The first principle of why God used a rib was so we could be side by side, shoulder by shoulder.
El segundo principio por qué Dios utilizó la costilla de Adán es el principio de protección.
The second principle of why God used Adam's rib is the principle of protection.
¿Y por qué protección? Porque la costilla, el costado, justamente está debajo del brazo.
And why protection? Because the rib, it's right here on the side below our arm.
Y eso describe, a ver, protección.
And that protección. Describes protection.
Familia, y este principio a mí me encanta porque como hombres somos los protectores del hogar.
Family, and I love this principle because as men, they are like the protectors of the house.
Nosotros queremos proteger a nuestra esposa, proteger a nuestra familia. Es nuestra naturaleza ser protectores.
We want to protect our family, protect our house. That's our nature, to be protectors.
Familia, y yo no tengo duda de que cualquier hombre que me está mirando en este momento no dudaría en defender y cuidar a su esposa si está en peligro.
Family, and I have no doubt that any man that is watching right now, if they see that their wife is in danger, they wouldn't go and defend her right away.
Si ve a su esposa en peligro, ese león que tiene adentro, ese oso que tiene adentro, saldría a dar la vida por su esposa.
If you see that your wife is in danger, that lion that you have inside of you, that bear that's inside of you, will just go and give your life for your wife.
Somos protectores por naturaleza, pero aquí entre hombre y hombre, familia, esa es la parte más fácil en el principio de proteger a nuestra esposa.
Men are protectors for nature, but right here between us, men and men, that is the easiest part of protecting our wife.
No solo Dios quiere que tú protejas físicamente a tu esposa, sino sobre todo protejas y cuides su corazón.
God doesn't only want you to protect your wife physically, but he also wants you to protect her heart.
Ese es el desafío para ti y para mí, proteger y cuidar el corazón de tu esposa.
That is a challenge for you and for me, to be able to protect our wife's heart.
¿Y cómo, Diego, cómo yo protejo, cómo yo cuido el corazón de mi esposa?
And how, Diego, how is it that I protect my wife's heart?
Familia, yo simplemente voy a ser real y te voy a decir cómo yo cuido el corazón de mi esposa.
Family, I just want to be real right now and I'm going to tell you how is it that I protect my wife's heart.
La mejor manera de cuidar el corazón de tu esposa es escúchela, escuchándola.
The best way for you to protect your wife's heart is for you to listen to her.
Otra de las maneras en que tú puedes cuidar y proteger el corazón de tu esposa es separar un tiempo para ella, para ustedes.
Another way that you can protect your wife's heart is to separate a space and a time for you, for both of you.
Y si quiero ser más real contigo en esta tarde, una manera en que usted puede proteger el corazón de su esposa es lave los platos en la cocina.
And if I can be more real this afternoon, another way that you can protect God's your wife's heart is for you to do the dishes in the kitchen.
Agarre la escoba y pase una escoba en la sala.
To sweep a little bit in the living room.
Y una que es que creo que a todas las mujeres esposas que me están viendo van a decir amén a esta es deje que su esposa tome un nap, un descanso.
And another one that I believe that every woman that hears this is going to say yes, amen, is let your wife take a nap.
Deje que su esposa descanse. De esas maneras, usted también está cuidando el corazón de su esposa.
Let your wife take a nap. That's another way for you to cherish and to take care of your wife's heart.
Y es interesante, familia, porque en el servicio anterior hablamos también de cómo no solo el hombre cuida el corazón de su mujer, sino también la mujer cuida el corazón de un hombre.
And it's amazing because in the past service we were talking about how it's not only men that have to take care of their wife's heart, but also us as women, we have to take care of our husband's heart.
Y siguiendo por esta línea de que Dios utilizó la costilla de Adán como un principio de protección,
and continuing with this principle that God used a rib from the side of Adam.
La mejor manera, señora, que usted puede cuidar el corazón de su marido es confiando en su cuidado, confiando en su palabra.
The best way that you can protect you as wives, that you can protect your husband's heart is trusting in his word, trusting in his care and protection.
Sí, confíe en su dirección, confíe en su esposo. Lo mejor que una mujer le puede dar a un hombre es honra.
Trust in your husband. Trust in the way that he's leading. The best thing that a wife can give a husband is honor.
Dios usó la costilla de Adán con un principio de igualdad, con un principio de protección y también
God used Adam's rib as a symbol of protection, as a symbol of equality, and also
usó la costilla de Adán porque está cerca del corazón para amar a su esposa.
He used Adam's rib because it's close to his heart, so for him to love your wife.
Y creo que en esta serie de enseñanzas, familia, lo que nos ha quedado muy claro a todos es que el amar a tu pareja no es un sentimiento, no es un estado de ánimo, es una decisión.
And something that we've been talking about since last week, and I believe it's very clear to all of us, is that love is not a feeling, it's not an emotion, but it's a decision.
Así es que familia, es por eso si alguna vez te preguntaste por qué la costilla de Adán, estos tres principios que están en la palabra de Dios nos ayudan a entender un poco.
So if you ever wonder why the rib, why Adam's rib, these three principles will help us understand a little bit more why, and we can find that in the Word of God.
El matrimonio es el plan, es el diseño de Dios, familia.
Marriage is God's plan, is God's design, family.
Y tan es así, quiero llegar al fondo del corazón de Dios para el matrimonio.
And I want to talk about deeper about God's heart for marriage.
Tan es así que fue el plan de Dios el matrimonio, que hasta la ceremonia de un matrimonio que hoy en día vivimos nace del primer matrimonio en la historia.
So like we're saying, it's God's plan, and we can see this because even like the first ceremony, this first marriage ceremony, it's born in the Word of God right here.
¿Alguna vez se ha preguntado usted por qué las bodas hoy en día, por qué su boda, mi boda, tuvo el mismo protocolo, tuvo la misma manera de hacer la ceremonia?
Have you ever asked yourself, have you ever wondered why is it that every single marriage follows the same protocol?
Por ejemplo, usted se ha preguntado por qué la costumbre es de que el padre de la novia entre con la novia y se la presente al novio. Es el mismo protocolo en la mayoría de matrimonios.
Like for example, in a wedding, why is it that we all follow the same protocol? Like we know that in most of the weddings, the man, the father, is the one that hands the wife to the husband.
Así es, ¿ya? Y mira lo que dice la palabra de Dios en el mismo verso que acabamos de leer.
And let me read to you what the word of God says in the same verse that we just read.
22.
On verse 22. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man.
Y se la presentó y la trajo hacia el varón.
So God presented her to the husband, to Adam in this case.
Familia, nuestro Dios por sobre todo es padre, y claramente la palabra de Dios dice que el padre trajo a la novia y se la presentó a Adán.
So family, our God, first of all, he is a father. And right here in the Word of God, we can clearly see that he took Eve and presented her to Adam and gave it to Adam.
¿No te parece familiar a las bodas de hoy en día? ¿No te parece familiar a tu boda cuando el padre de la novia presenta a la novia al hombre, al novio?
Doesn't this sound familiar? Doesn't it remind you of your wedding day, if you're married, the moment where the father gives the wife the wife to the husband?
Estoy haciendo toda esta historia, familia, con el propósito de que hoy día entendamos que el matrimonio entre un hombre y una mujer fue diseñado detalladamente por Dios.
I'm making this whole story around. I'm just talking about this so that we understand that marriage was designed by God.
Y hay otro ejemplo. ¿Tú te acuerdas, familia, cuando el padre entra con la novia y usted recibe a la novia? ¿Qué es lo primero que le dijo a ella?
And there's this other part of the ceremony. You know, when the father is walking with the bride, that's the word, with the bride towards the groom, and the moment that the groom sees the bride.
Lo primero que le dijiste. Yo recuerdo, y me acuerdo que le dije, estás hermosa.
The first thing that the groom says to the bride, the first thing I remember when I was getting married, the first thing I said was, you look beautiful.
Y estoy seguro que cada caballero que está aquí va a recordar que lo primero que le dijo fue un halago, un piropo.
And every man that is married right now is going to remember that the first thing that you said at that moment was something nice to her.
Qué hermosa estás, qué bella te ves.
How beautiful you are, how gorgeous you look.
Recuerdas ese momento, los nervios, pero lo primero que salió de tu boca fue un halago.
You remember that moment that even in the middle of being so nervous, the first thing that came out of your mouth was something nice to her.
Familia, de la misma manera, en el primer matrimonio de la historia entre Adán, Eva y Dios,
the same way, family, in the first marriage that we've ever seen taking place between Adam and Eve,
Dios trajo a la novia, se la presentó a Adán, y Adán soltó el primer piropo de la historia.
God brought the bride, he introduced her to Adam, and Adam said the first nice words to her.
Mira lo que dice Adán en el verso 23.
Look what Adam says in verse 23. The man said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of a man."
Ella es hueso de mis huesos, carne de mi carne. El primer piropo que Adán le dijo a Eva.
She's bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. That's the first thing that Adam told Eve right there in the moment.
Familia, me imagino a Adán en ese momento lleno de emoción, lleno de ansiedad, ya querer contraer matrimonio con Eva.
Family, I can imagine Adam at that moment so excited and so anxious to be able to marry Eve.
Y Dios en ese momento diciendo, ya no perdamos más el tiempo, vamos a casar a esta hermosa pareja.
And I can imagine God at that moment saying, let's not waste more time and let's marry them.
Y recuerdas en el matrimonio también cuando estás a punto de casarte y el pastor celebra y bendice el matrimonio.
And just like in your wedding when you're about to get married and the pastor celebrates and blesses this union.
Uh-huh. Los declaro marido y mujer, lo que ha unido Dios, que no lo separe el hombre.
I declare you husband and wife, what God united, let not be separated by man.
¿Recuerdas esa ceremonia celebrando el matrimonio? Es el mismo protocolo que Dios usó.
Remember that ceremony when you celebrated your wedding? That's the same protocol that God used.
Y Dios dijo en el verso 24, en el verso 24, sí, exactamente.
And God
después
said in verse 24, right after, "That is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh."
En otras palabras, Dios celebró el matrimonio y los bendijo.
In other words, God celebrated marriage and he blessed them.
Los declaro marido y mujer, a Adán y a Eva.
I declare you husband and wife, he said to Adam and Eve.
Familia, nuevamente, cada detalle de lo que hemos leído, el propósito es entender que el matrimonio viene desde lo profundo del corazón de Dios.
Again, family, every detail that we just read, for us, the purpose that we have is for us to understand that marriage is the perfect design that comes from God.
Y hay un principio aquí, familia, que quiero hacer un paréntesis y dirigirme a las personas que aún no están casadas, a los jóvenes.
And right now, I just want to make this parenthesis in the conversation and speak to the people that are watching right now, like maybe the young people that are not married yet.
A las personas que están teniendo una segunda oportunidad en el amor.
Maybe people that are having a second opportunity in love.
Hay un principio que Dios estipuló, que Dios marcó claramente entre la relación entre un hombre y una mujer.
There's a principle that God established right here between a man and a woman for marriage.
Y dijo,
for union.
Por tanto, el hombre dejará a su padre y a su madre, se unirá a su mujer y los dos juntos se fundirán en una sola carne.
So he says that man, first of all, leaves the father and the mother and is united to his wife, and then they become one flesh.
Hay un principio de orden, familia, un principio de orden.
There is an order principle, family, right here. We see an order of
lo primero que dice Dios, el hombre dejará a su padre y a su madre con la bendición de ellos, dejará a su padre y a su madre.
The first thing that it says here is that a man will leave their father and mother with the blessings of the father and the mother.
El segundo orden es se unirá a su mujer. Claramente se refiere a la unión matrimonial, a la boda civil, a la boda religiosa.
The second part, the second stage, is that he will unite to his wife. This clearly is talking about a marriage, that union, either a civil union or a religious one.
Dejará a su padre y a su madre, se casará con su mujer, y el tercer orden se unirá en una sola carne. Eso significa la intimidad sexual dentro del matrimonio.
So first of all, they leave mother and father. The second part is they get married. This union, and then the third part is that he becomes one flesh with a wife, which clearly is talking about that intimacy, that sexual intimacy.
Ese es el orden establecido por Dios desde el origen del primer matrimonio celebrado en la historia de la humanidad.
That is the order established by God from right from the origin, from the first ever marriage celebrated in humanity.
Y familia, muchas veces el mundo nos vende la idea, pero al revés.
And a lot of times, family, the world just sells this idea in a different way, the other way, the opposite way.
Muchas veces el mundo nos dice, primero prueba si te va bien, primero intenta si te va bien, y después cásate.
So the world usually tells, you know, let's just try and see how it goes. Let's see if this is going to work out between you two. And if it does, then you can go and get married.
Pero hay un orden establecido por Dios. Y como yo siempre le digo a mi hija mayor, a mis hijos, es la verdad.
But there is an order established by God. And like I always tell my kids, this order is the truth.
Un orden establecido por Dios para la relación entre un hombre y una mujer desde el principio de la creación.
An order that God established for a man and a woman right there from the beginning of creation.
Así es, familia. Y cuando hablamos de matrimonio, cuando hablamos del matrimonio, otro principio que quiero compartir contigo es que el matrimonio no es un contrato. El matrimonio es un pacto.
The other principle that I want to share with you right today is that marriage is not a contract between two people. Marriage is a covenant.
Es un pacto especial porque es un pacto de a tres.
It's a special covenant because it's a special covenant done between three of us. Three.
El hombre, la mujer y Dios.
Man, women and God.
Familia. Y es curioso cuando yo pienso en la palabra pacto y en la palabra contrato.
And family, it's funny because I start thinking about the word covenant and the word contract.
Y quiero que si puedes escribir esto, un contrato tiene condiciones, un pacto tiene compromisos.
And if you can write this down, a contract has conditions, but
a pacto tiene compromisos.
Yes, but a covenant has a compromise.
Y eso es lo hermoso del matrimonio, un compromiso a largo plazo.
And that is the beauty of marriage, that covenant, that compromise between two people to the long road.
Los contratos fácilmente se rompen.
Contracts are easily broken.
Pero los pactos, dice la palabra de Dios, y ahora lo vamos a ver, difícilmente se rompen.
But covenants, they hardly break, and we can see it right now in the Word of God.
Mira lo que dice Eclesiastés 4:12.
Look what the Word of God says in Ecclesiastes 4:12. It says, though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. A cord of three strands is not quickly broken.
Como dije al comienzo, familia, el matrimonio es un pacto, pero un pacto de a tres.
Family, like I said at the beginning, marriage is a covenant, but a covenant between three.
Y llama mi atención porque la palabra de Dios dice que uno puede ser vencido.
And it catches my attention that the Word of God says that one can easily be overpowered.
Y la mayoría de veces pensamos, familia, que este versículo, cuando dice uno puede ser vencido, quiere decir al número de personas, uno solo, uno.
And a lot of times when we read this passage, we think that when it says one, it's talking about the amount of people, like one person.
Pero realmente lo que quiere decir este versículo que se refiere al matrimonio cuando dice uno solo puede ser vencido.
But really what this verse means when it's talking about marriage, when it says that one can easily be overpowered.
Se refiere a cuando tú dentro del matrimonio piensas solamente en ti.
It's talking about when inside marriage we're only thinking about ourselves.
Cuando dentro del matrimonio piensas egoístamente.
When you're thinking selfish, being selfish in your marriage.
Cuando dentro del matrimonio piensas que solamente se trata de ti.
When you're inside your marriage, you're thinking it's always about me.
Uno solo puede ser vencido, familia, cuando dentro del matrimonio piensas egoístamente.
one by itself can easily be overpowered when you're being selfish in marriage.
Porque familia, el egoísmo debilita, el amor fortalece.
Because family selfishness makes us weak, but love makes us strong.
Es por eso que la palabra de Dios dice, uno solo puede ser vencido. Uno solo se va a debilitar y puede ser vencido.
That is why the word of God says that one by itself can become weak and can be overpowered.
Y déjame explicártelo, familia. Cuando en el matrimonio solo piensas en ti, siempre vas a querer más y más y más.
Let me explain it this way. When in marriage you're always thinking only about yourself, you're always going to want more and more and more.
Y por ende te cansarás, te agotarás y serás vencido.
And therefore you'll get tired and then you will be overpowered.
Porque el egoísmo debilita, el amor fortalece.
Because selfishness makes us weak, but love makes us strong.
Y no sé si te has puesto a pensar en esto, familia. Siempre que se trata de uno, siempre que se trata de ti.
And I don't know if you've thought about this, family, but every time that it's when you're thinking that it's always about yourself,
es muy difícil satisfacer.
It's very hard to be satisfied.
El egoísmo es muy difícil de satisfacer.
Being selfish, it's very hard to be satisfied.
Pero el amor es muy fácil de satisfacer.
But love is easy to satisfy.
Porque el amor se trata de dar. Y es fácil dar, es fácil satisfacer.
Because love is about giving and it's very easy to satisfy that.
Uno puede ser vencido. El egoísmo debilita, el amor fortalece.
One can be overpowered because selfishness makes us weak, but love makes us strong.
Y la palabra de Dios sigue y dice, dos pueden resistir. Uno puede ser vencido, dos pueden resistir.
Now the word of God continues saying two can defend themselves. So one can be overpowered, but two can defend themselves.
Pero tres, la cuerda de tres hilos difícilmente se rompe.
But three, a cord of three strands is not quickly broken.
Familia, yo te pregunto en esta mañana, ¿usted quiere un matrimonio egoísta donde muy fácil será vencido?
Family, I want to ask you this morning, do you want a marriage, a selfish marriage, when you will easily be broken and overpowered?
¿O usted quiere un matrimonio de a dos donde a duras penas se mantenga en pie?
Or do you want a marriage of two where you're both fighting and trying to get there?
Un matrimonio de a dos donde usted se mantenga por sus propias fuerzas.
A marriage between two people where you're using your own strength to keep on going.
Un matrimonio de a dos cuando tal vez viene un viento muy fuerte, una tormenta muy fuerte a tu matrimonio. Y ese viento tumba el matrimonio de a dos.
That marriage of two people when a huge and a strong storm comes and just really quickly makes you fall apart.
Porque un matrimonio de a dos estás valiéndote por tus propias fuerzas.
Because in a marriage between two people you're using your own strength.
O usted quiere un matrimonio de a tres. Un pacto de a tres.
Or do you want a marriage between three? This covenant between three.
Donde dice la palabra de Dios que muy difícilmente se rompa.
Where the word of God says that it's very quick, it's not quickly be broken.
En otras palabras, familia, usted quiere un matrimonio para disfrutarlo, no para aguantarlo.
In other words, family, do you want a marriage where you don't have to just go by it or go with it, but actually enjoy it?
Familia, y quiero ser claro con esto, disfrutar del matrimonio no quiere decir que hayan momentos difíciles.
And I want to be clear with this. To be able to enjoy your marriage doesn't mean that there will be no hard moments.
Disfrutar del matrimonio no quiere decir que no haya temporadas de tormenta.
Being able to enjoy your marriage doesn't mean that there won't be any storms, any bad seasons in your life.
Disfrutar del matrimonio quiere decir que en esas temporadas difíciles, ese tercer doblez, esa tercera cuerda esté presente.
To be able to enjoy your marriage means that in those tough seasons, that third cord will be there present.
Y esa tercera cuerda es Jesucristo.
And that third court is Jesus.
¿Usted quiere un matrimonio para disfrutarlo? ¿O usted quiere un matrimonio para aguantarlo? ¿O un matrimonio que fácilmente, egoístamente se rompa?
Do you want a marriage to be able to enjoy it, or you just want to go with it and have to carry this heaviness with you, or just easily be broken?
Familia, para disfrutar del matrimonio, yo te animo que hoy día, si tú estás casado o casada y quieres disfrutar del matrimonio,
family, to be able to enjoy your marriage, I want to encourage you this morning, this afternoon, if you are married,
que invites al Señor Jesús a esa cuerda, a esa tercera cuerda, a ese tercer doblez que hace el pacto perfecto en el matrimonio, que le invites a tu matrimonio.
I want to encourage you to invite Jesus to your marriage, to invite that third cord that makes it perfect to your marriage.
No importa si usted tiene un año de casado, no importa si tiene 10, si tiene 25, 50, no lo sé.
It doesn't matter if you've been married for 1 year, for 10, for 25 or 50.
Siempre, siempre está la oportunidad que usted invite a ese tercer doblez dentro de su matrimonio.
There is always an opportunity for you to invite that third cord into your marriage.
¿Y sabes qué es lo maravilloso de todo, familia? Que ese tercer doblez, el Señor Jesús, siempre está a la puerta de su matrimonio, siempre.
And the most amazing thing, family, is that Jesus, that third cord, is always right there at the door of your marriage.
Lo único que Él está esperando es que usted abra la puerta de su matrimonio para que Él entre a disfrutar con usted.
The only thing He's waiting is for you to open the door of your marriage so He can come and enjoy it with you.
Familia, si hoy día usted está diciendo, Diego, yo quiero disfrutar de mi matrimonio, yo quiero invitar al Señor Jesús dentro de mi matrimonio.
Family, if you're watching right now and you're saying, Diego, I want to invite Jesus into my marriage.
Esta es tu oportunidad. Dios siempre está disponible.
This is your opportunity. God is always available.
Solamente voy a cerrar guiándote en una oración. Si eres tú, esposa, tu esposo, si están juntos y dicen, quiero invitar a Jesús a mi vida, a mi matrimonio.
I just want to guide you in this prayer. If you're there, your husband, your wife, you're next to each other and you say, I want to invite Jesus into my relationship.
Déjame guiarte en una oración y básicamente, como dije, es abrir las puertas de tu matrimonio, las puertas de tu corazón para recibir al Señor Jesús.
Let me guide you in this prayer. And like I said, this is basically just opening the doors of your marriage, opening the door of your heart and receive Jesus.
Padre nuestro que estás en el cielo.
Heavenly Father.
Hoy día quiero entregar mi vida, mi matrimonio a Jesús.
Today I want to give my life, my marriage to Jesus.
Hoy día abro las puertas de mi corazón.
Today I want to open the doors of my heart.
Y te acepto como el Señor y Salvador de mi vida y de mi matrimonio.
And I want to accept you as my Lord and Savior over my life and my marriage.
Padre, enséñame a vivir por ti.
Father, teach me how to live for you.
Enséñame los principios del matrimonio.
Teach me those principles in marriage.
Y a amar como tú me amaste.
And to love like you love me.
Te entrego esta decisión en el nombre de Jesús.
I give you this decision in the name of Jesus.
Amén.
Amen.
Familia, si usted ha hecho esta oración, déjame decirte que es la mejor decisión que usted ha tomado en su vida.
Family, if you've made this decision, I want you to know that it's the best decision you've made in your life.
Y solo te animo a que te mantengas conectado con Favor Church a través del Facebook, del Instagram, del YouTube.
And I want to encourage you to stay connected with Favor Church through Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube.
Queremos ser parte de tu vida y sobre todo conocerte para que usted bendiga nuestra vida.
We want to be part of your life and we want to know you because you bless our lives as well.
Familia, que Dios me los bendiga, que tengan la mejor semana de todas y nos vemos conectados a través de las redes sociales.
Family, may God bless you and have the best week yet, and we'll see each other in social media and YouTube.